As you would have seen in the last discussion, the issues, aspirations, and concerns of the two countries are different, but there's a lot of commonality. There's a lot of focus on increasing participation in our democracies. The next panel will discuss democracy and governance, governance and democracy in India. We have with us a very eminent speaker from India, Mr. Dhananjay Singh. Mr. Dhananjay Singh is a Director General and National Board Member, National Human Resource Development Network. He was Executive Director NHRDN from 2011 to 17. It is the largest network of HR professionals in India. Prior to joining NHRDN, he worked with All India Management Association, the national apex body of management profession in India, on various management development initiatives of IMA. Mr. Singh worked closely with organizations like Tata Group, NTPC, IBM. Across the board, he has served various private and public sector corporations. He has also worked with management professionals such as Dr. Jagdish Sheth, Dr. John Fleming, Dr. Linda Gratton. I think we have a management guru amongst us. Mr. Dhananjay Singh, could you please come up? The next member of the panel is Mr. Sandeep Chakravorty, the Consul General of India in New York. Mr. Chakravorty is a member of the Indian Foreign Service since 1996. he has served in India's mission in several countries. Prior to becoming Consul General of India in New York, he was Ambassador of India to India to Peru and Bolivia. He had been India's Deputy Chief of Mission in Bangladesh as well. I must say he was very popular there. He has also served in Indian embassies in Madrid and Bogota. In India's Ministry of External Affairs, he has held several positions, including press relations officer, staff officer to minister, and has worked on desks dealing with Central Asia, East Asia, and China. Before joining the government, Mr. Chakravorty worked with civil society organizations dealing with natural resources and environmental issues. He has a master's degree in advanced studies in international security from Geneva University, a master's degree in sociology, and as well as a postgraduate diploma in forestry management. He graduated in physics from Delhi University. The other point which I would like to mention is that he, not because he's my boss, but as a member of the fellow member of the Indian Foreign Service, his innovations and initiatives within the government are much admired, and we all look up to him for those. To moderate the panel discussion, we have an India expert, Richard Rossow. Rick is a senior advisor and he holds the Wadhwani chair in US-India policy studies at CSIS. In his role, he helps frame and shape policies to promote greater business and economic engagement between the two countries. He joined CSIS in 2014, having spent the last 16 years working in various capacities to strengthen the partnerships between the United States and India. Prior to joining CSIS full-time, he was served as director for South Asia at McLarty Associates, a consulting firm. And from 2008 to 12, he was with New York Life Insurance Company. From 98 to 2008, from 1998 to 2008, he served as deputy director of US-India Business Council. I was telling him that he took India-US relations from the nuclear test to the nuclear deal. While at IABC, he also managed Consul's policy groups in the energy, information technology, and insurance. Well, you know, I follow him on Twitter, and probably you should all as well. If you want to know tractors cost more in Punjab or in Tamil Nadu, or whether the National Highways Authority of India is performing better in Jharkhand or in Telangana, he's the man to ask the questions. So I would hand over to Rick for further proceedings.
Thanks. I hope nobody asked me those specific questions, because I didn't come prepared to answer that. But what a great keystone this is, I think, from the conversations that we've had so far today. You know, looking at democracy and governance, you know, you think about governance and what that kind of means. We've had elements of it all throughout the program today, different programs the government of India has announced, things that voters want to see. But voters, it really does come down to the crux of it. What do voters want to see? How do you see them portray that when it comes to election time? You know, you look back and you think back, is it solid social programs like we're discussed today? Is it about job creation? Is it about handouts to people, you know, blatant handouts? Is it things like even looking at foreign affairs, you know, having the Consul General up here, you know, what does that matter to voters in India when they think of governance for their nation and what that means for election time? Sometimes India is referred to as a functioning anarchy, but none of us can believe that is truly the case. But finding the heart of voters has been a very difficult exercise. Thinking back in my experience, 20 years now working on U.S.-India relations, a few kind of notables, when you think about the connectivity between what governments have tried to deliver and what voters have, how they've rewarded that or not, you look back at 2004, which to me remains one of India's seminal elections, when you had a sitting government, the Vajpayee government, that was running, you know, based pretty much on the promotion of urbanization. These great rising capitals, Hyderabad, Bangalore, you know, Chennai taking off, even Gurgaon, the roots of, and the Indian Shining campaign ended up not being an electoral winner. There's lots of factors, but that's one that often gets pointed out. So urbanization has not been seen so far necessarily as a winner. Think back to, is development the thing? Well, you look back at the states that generally are seen as the most developed in India. Kerala, Goa, Tamil Nadu. I mean, those three states, how many times have they reelected governments in the last 50 years? Twice total. You know, Kerala has never reelected a government since it became a state. So development isn't necessarily the thing. Is it doing business factors? You know, is it having a functioning economy? Well, we just saw state governments and the BJP losing in three states, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, and Chhattisgarh, and all three were in the top 10 in India in government's own ease of doing business ranking. So it's been really tricky, I think, to figure out what exactly is the system. And even on handouts, again, looking back at Tamil Nadu, the state that I studied to first learn a bit about Indian politics, Tamil Nadu parties have thrown out everything that can't be nailed down to voters, you know, bicycles, gold chains, TVs, healthcare, everything. And still, you know, difficult to get reelected. So I don't have any of the answers here. I'm merely to say that we've pretty much have figured out so far that those are the things that state governments and federal government have tried and haven't necessarily worked. And that's why it's great to have two incredible experts up here to shed a bit of light. When you think about governance, what is it that voters want to see? What do they want to see delivered that helps to make India's democracy function and work well? So, you know, I think that, you know, looking back, we've heard some great speakers so far that have touched on elements of this, but I think, you know, Dhananjay and the terrific experiences that you had so far, I'd love to hear, you know, 8 or 10 minutes, if you can, of kind of opening remarks and how you think this fits in based on your, you know, incredible experiences dealing with the private sector, dealing with management, dealing with governance as you've seen it. So over to you, sir.
Thank you indeed. Friends, before I begin, I'll request you, we have two hands. So one from US and one for India, and put them together to thank this partnership of US and India, please. Let's hear for US. Thank you. Governance is an experience. And this experience is at three levels. Experience of individuals, experience of different groups which are there in the society, and experience of the nation as a whole. In Indian democracy, we call it Jan, which is individuals, Gan, which is groups which are there in any society, and Man, which is the collective of experience of governance. If it is an experience at all these three levels which run simultaneously, then it is an experience of what? It is an experience of intent, of people who are running governance, who are responsible for governance, and the execution, how the services are delivered to people. That experience is governance. The uniqueness of governance is it is cause as well as the effect. It is cause. Accountability, whether it is bureaucratic accountability or the political accountability, is a cause. And it is also effect. Participation of people, stakeholders, in any democracy is very, very important. Cause and effect again. Rule of the law. We talked about RTI. In fact, ma'am talked about RTI. We talk about responsiveness. Maybe people are accountable, but they are not responsive. In governance, people talk about equality. They talk about inclusiveness. They talk about effective governance. They talk about governance which is not only effective, but it is also efficient. It delivers on time. And how robust are our grievance handling abilities? Because any democracy will have grievances. And what's our ability to handle such grievances? And this is all universal. It is not unique to India. It's all universal. Now, when we focus on this topic, the Indian governance, very briefly in 2-3 minutes, I'll talk about 1910. And that was the year when people talked about the self-local governance which was available in India for centuries, for thousands and thousands of years. India may be a new democratic country, but as a nation, as a civilization, it's very, very old. And in 1911, we have a book called Arthashastra. Those who are from India, they know that book. It was found in one of the libraries in the King of Mysore. And that was a time when universal franchise was not available in India. Even if we talk about the last, in terms of Britishers, the Government of India Act, 1935, the franchise was available based on religion, based on gender, but it was not available on a universal basis to India. 15th August 1947, when we became independent country, and 26th January 1950, when our constitution came and which gave equal right to every citizen in the country. If you remember, those who know, we have talked about Baba Saheb Ambedkar. He clearly talked about that on 26th January 1950, India will attain a political freedom, which we attained on 15th August 1947. Constitution will deliver equality on the grounds of constitution to every single people, citizen of the country. But we have to fight for the social and economic justice, which my friends in the past have talked about in the previous sessions. 1947, 85% of Indians were illiterate. 85%. Today we have over 80% literacy in the country. We have really moved.
Give me the date again, I forget.
Sir? 85% were illiterate. 1947, when we, yes, sir. Illiterate. Yeah? Illiterate people were there, and that's why universal franchise given to people of the country is not a small thing, not at all. The belief was, Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, who became the president of India later, he said, based on the civilization of the country and the people who have lived through the ethics and integrity, even after gulami of thousands and thousands of years, they deserve one person, one vote kind of system in the country. And this is what the genesis of universal franchise of our India. 47, 52, when the first general election happened, 51 to 52, we had refugees coming to India. And think about the country which is just now became independent, going through wars, civil war. People are shifting from one country to another country based on religion. See the inclusivity. People said, we will give the universal franchise to even the refugees who are coming to my country. On what basis? What was the law? Law said you should be 21 years of your age. 180 years, 180 days you must have lived in the country. It was not available to them. Then what we should do? Then they agreed that we just need a self-declaration from you that you want to live in this country. And that's it. And see the paradox. 2.8 million women who were there in our country, they even did not have their identity. Their identity was, the lady is mother of so-and-so, wife of so-and-so, daughter of so-and-so. They were stuck off from the roles in India. So when we are talking about Indian democracy, we have to be very mindful. It's a very unique game. I was talking to the gentleman, the chair, and I asked him, what is the population of this city, New Jersey? It's about 10 million. And I shared with him, right now, as we sit here in Prayagraj, Kumbh Mela is happening. On one day, 50 million people took holy bath in the river. They all are human beings, they're not robots. They use transport. They come to the city. They eat. They need shelter. They need whatever we need, all of us require. And this is the guest list on one single day. And there are citizens who are there, who live there in that city. Yeah, I know, you talked about Harsh. So that's the kind of reimagining governance which India is delivering on the ground. Not even a single incident. People are lost, 45,000 people in a day. How do we know who they are? We are not bothered by, because we have our Aadhaar system in place. Put your thumb and we know everything about you. You belong to which part of the country, you belong to whatever, all details are available. That's the use of technology in delivering democracy in the country. My friends have talked about certain yojanas, certain plans which the government of India is implementing. In 1992, we delivered Panchayati Raj. We gave power to people on the ground, in the villages, municipalities. So Indian democracy is not only what we hear in the media or see in the media. Indian democracy is much, much deeper into the Indian ethos of living, the way of life, which believes in treating people equally. Across the globe, you will find all religion. You'll find all 4,635 communities. It's a huge opportunity. As well, it's a huge challenge. So when we talk about governance and democracy, it is not only at the level of Jan, which is individuals. No, not at all. Not at all. Democracy is how we treat groups. It's how we create the unseen spine of a nation. How we align individuals to groups to nation. That's democracy. What will happen to this hall if each one of us who are bundle of energy, they start running in all kind of directions? What will happen to this hall? And what will happen to this hall if we decide as a group that we will move in this direction? What is the vector which we create as citizens, as group of people, keeping the one nation in mind? That's democracy. These are my opening thoughts, sir. Over to you, please.
Thank you. Thank you. Dhananjay, very inspiring. And I just will take off from your mentioning of Kumbh Mela. Earlier, couples who wanted to get rid of each other used to go together to Kumbh Mela, hoping that, you know, they will lose the husband or the wife. But unfortunately, this year, many couples are unhappy because they lost their spouse, but, you know, the lost and found service was so good, they got them back. So this is also a downside of a very efficient system. Thank you, Dhananjay ji and Rick. I think you set the tone, the bar very high for me. I would take off from what Rick mentioned, that what is that people, common people, expect from the government, and what is really governance? And I have had more than two decades of experience in government, because earlier, you know, I used to think when I was a student that India is an amazing sociological laboratory of people and communities and religions and ethnic groups. But more and more I have been seeing my country, I also believe it's an amazing political laboratory. All kinds of political thought prevail in India. I think India is the only country where a communist government comes to power and then loses the election and leaves, because communists, once they gain power, they never leave. I think India is the only example in the world where communists are voted into power and they are voted out of power. I don't think that has happened anywhere in the world. And so that's India for us. And all strains of public opinion are there. The previous panelist was talking about Naxals. Naxals are, for those who are not familiar with the word Naxals, they are Maoists. They subscribe to ideology of Chairman Mao, which may not find many followers in China today, but they have followers in India. So we have even that stream of political thought in India. So that it just shows how complex the Indian political scenario is. And we have, of course, the federal structure. We have a federal government. We have a state government. And we have local self-government. And somehow operating at all these layers is the bureaucracy. Of which I am a part, and the bureaucracy is known as the steel frame of India. Now, people may have opinions about the Indian bureaucracy, whether we need the bureaucracy or not. I think there are two big countries in the world which are comparable in size and in economy and various dimensions are the United States which doesn't have a bureaucracy, and China, which has a bureaucracy, but Chinese bureaucracy is a political bureaucracy. Whereas I think India is a unique situation where the bureaucracy is not a political bureaucracy, it serves the political party in power. Now that creates its own challenges, but I think it is also largely responsible for the success of the Indian democratic example, because we did not have the spoil system that we have in the United States, where bureaucrats change with the government. No matter who wins the next elections, I will remain the Consul General unless I unless I goof up badly and I am recalled. So that's very comforting, and that encourages me to talk openly in this forum. I would just like to mention that what Rick was mentioning. What is that common man looks at the government when he or she interacts with it? I believe that the common person looks for response. Responsiveness is the first attribute, or the primary attribute of any government. What people don't like is indifference or lack of response, because all governments, I believe, the political process, I believe, survives on problem solving. A politician wants to solve problems of the people. But what the common people wants is response. So if you go to a district in India, you will find hundreds of people in the house of a politician. And he may not have all the tools in his hands to respond, to solve the problem of the common man. But you will find people in his house. But you go to the house of a district collector who has the tools to solve the problems, you will not find too many people there. Because I think people find response at the door of a politician. And I think unless we change the bureaucratic system, unless the bureaucratic system becomes responsive, I think governance will be a challenge in India. What I have seen over the last few years is that the political system has forced the bureaucratic system to become responsive. So today, our road transport corporation or the police, in fact, I was quite surprised to find tweets from the Kumbh Mela organizers. The Kumbh Mela police is tweeting, you know, and somebody has lost, they're immediately tweeting and, you know, finding the spouse of the lost husband or wife. So I was in, and some of them were tagging the consulate in New York, I don't know why. So I got lots of tweets on Kumbh Mela. So I think, you know, Twitter is a powerful medium. It shows the responsiveness of the government. People who travel on Indian railways, if the train is late, they tweet the railway minister. And he makes sure that the train speeds up. So it is incredible degree of responsiveness that has been ushered in India in the last several years, thanks to technology, thanks to the vision of the government, thanks to the reorientation of the Indian bureaucracy, thanks to reorientation of the Indian diplomatic service. I think all of us are on our toes all the time, trying to respond to the grievance of the people. I believe that a country like India, which has challenges, which has scarcity of resources, where there are too many demands on the system, we may not be able to solve problems of the people. But I believe that if we respond, even if you say, no, I can't do it, I think people get a lot of satisfaction. And I think the more and more we use technology, and all these previous panels have talked about inclusiveness, talked about Jan Dhan Yojana, talked of Aadhaar, talked of Mudra scheme, Stand Up India, Startup India. I think these are all schemes, but at the end of the day, these are mechanisms where state, the government, is responding to the needs of the people. Earlier, the state was elitist. It would only respond to the needs of certain category of people, people who had access to higher education, people who belong to what we know as the upper caste, or people who had heritage and legacy in India. I think what has happened with technology in the recent years and all these inclusive schemes is that that hierarchy has been broken. And all kinds of people are putting demand on the system, whether they are the Dalits or the minorities or women. And the system is responding. And that's why we have these incredible figures where Milinji mentioned that 70% of the beneficiaries of a particular scheme were women, or they are Dalit, or that Mr. Pasha, Sayyid Zafarul Islam mentioned that more than 25% of the beneficiaries of the Ujala scheme are minorities. I think these are indicators that the system is breaking the hierarchy. It is taking governance to the people, and the government is responding. And I see the best example in our Ministry of External Affairs or in the consulate, where we are trying to respond to, I use the word attack, on the consulate from all quarters, whether it is on Twitter, on Facebook. People are even Snapchatting us. Can you believe it? And I don't know how to use Snapchat. So I have a Snapchat account. I was forced to open a Snapchat account because I was told that certain section of the people, like youngsters, they only talk to you on Snapchat. And my daughters were amazed that, why did you? I said, just to connect to people, of that age group. We are not able to connect to that age group. So what we are trying to do is respond continuously. And I think that there the difference will come in governance, where people will realize that, the government structures that have been created in the last 70 years, they are responding to the needs of the
people. That's great thoughts. But let me ask you, on your own personal experience. So here you are. You've been an outpost in Latin America. You're here in New York City. You've got the investment community, the diaspora. Obviously the tweeting that we see with the honorable minister, a lot of that is, visa issues and somebody trapped and a relative that deceased and things. But you're at the outpost now. You're representing the government of India. You're trying to help deliver governance. When you think of the person in rural Bihar, in Uttar Pradesh, how do you connect your role here in terms of helping governance, back in the home country, things that they want to see the government provide? What is the role of the Foreign Service in having this diplomatic corps out there? What are some of the, main things that you think about when you wake up in the morning of how can I help Mother India function more effectively from this outpost in New York? Can you give us a sense about what that kind of looks like in your day job and how it connects back to, voters back home and things they care about that you work on?
I think, it's a very, very relevant question because I think that makes all of us, particularly diplomats, question the relevance of our external service, our diplomatic service to, what is the objective of the Indian diplomatic service? It is to prepare an external environment conducive for the transformation of India. So the transformation of India will not happen only by the efforts of people within India. The transformation of India will happen with the efforts of people within India, people outside India, and friends of India who live outside India. And I think our role comes in the last two categories that I mentioned. People of India who live outside India, the Indian diaspora, and people and friends of India, people like Rick. How do we connect these two categories of people or communities or countries to India? That is our role. And how do we do it? We do it by issuing a visa. Every tourist that goes to India, he spends money in India. So if I can issue a visa quickly in a day, in half a day, I'll make sure that the tourist travels to India. He goes to India, he creates jobs for a person in Bodh Gaya. He visits Kumbh Mela, he creates jobs in India. I facilitate an investor to go to India. He looks at all the options. And if I'm able to convince him that, don't go to China, come to India, I help my country. So I think there are many ways where we play a role. If I'm responsive to him, if I give a positive image of my country, if I'm helpful, if I'm friendly, I think we influence people, opinions at a particular level, at an individual level, at a public opinion level, in the media, and general positive impression about India. I think those help in decisions which help my countrymen back home in Bihar or in Madhya Pradesh or in Andaman and Nicobar Islands. I think that is the role of our service, interpreting India to the foreigner or the Indian diaspora. More and more they involve themselves in India, I think, my job of transforming India gets fulfilled.
Great response, sir. Dhananjay, looking at the different levels of governance in India, and after I ask this one, I'll throw it open for a few minutes for the audience, but, one question that I've got for you, maybe you can shed some light. So, a lot of times, especially from a distance, we focus on Delhi. What did the Prime Minister eat for breakfast? What the Parliament do? That kind of stuff. But state governments are enormously powerful and in some ways more powerful than American state governments. City government's less powerful in a lot of ways, although some cities have pretty powerful municipal corporations. When you think about citizens, voters' expectation for governance, how would you characterize in terms of perceptions of the central government and what they expect for delivery versus state governments? Is there a difference? I mean, obviously they have different functions, you know, national security and defense for the national government, water and electricity for the states, but do they have different expectations for the state government? When they think about who it is that impacts their lives on a regular basis, how much weightage do they attribute to the central government versus state government? I think for this audience, getting a bit of insight in center versus states would be very important.
Thank you. I'll first talk about the overall shift, the voter shift. 47, the voting percentage was 44.87%. 2014, it was 66.4%. So in nutshell, the percentage of voting has increased 47 to 2014. 117 MPs out of 539 who were elected in 2014, they got more than 50% of votes. While in India, as you know, even Supreme Court has said that representation comes later. First comes your voice and your authority and your right to your voice. So maybe people who have 20%, 30% of the vote, they also become member of parliament, which means it is not more than 51% or 50%. That's on the overall larger canvas. The voting patterns and voters, when they vote for municipality elections, panchayat elections, MLAs and MPs, you will find it's a very intelligent choice which they make. They don't go by what media is saying. They're very clear what they want when they are electing a person for a panchayat in a village. And those agendas are very, very specific and clear. They're very clear about it. The voters are very clear that, okay, this person will deliver, this councillor will deliver to me A, B, C. MLA will deliver to me on these accounts, and union government will deliver to me XYZ. That kind of clarity is very much there in the country. And I'll give you an example. Indian democracy has gone through some very dark clouds. And I'll talk about an incident of 1975, 12th June, when then Prime Minister and one member of parliament who lost actually election, he challenged that, okay, you have done something wrong. And in Indian democracy, as sir was talking about, judiciary is very independent. And judiciary gave an order that then Prime Minister, she cannot fight election for 6 years. Night of 25th June 1975, 26 June, emergency was declared in the country. Prime Minister did a lot of things during the time of emergency, but still she lost the election. What is the lesson? That only economic indicators or indicators where you can push the agenda which you have in mind because you have the authority will not live long as far as Indian democracy is concerned. It is challenged. And even that year, Supreme Court clearly said that government is responsible to the people. They cannot say that just because it is important and it is secret, so I'll not reveal. And that became the base to right to information. So as far as the clarity voters are concerned, and in the larger canvas of Indian democracy, we don't look at people just as voters. We are responsible for their physical, emotional, and spiritual well-being and growth.
Because when I'm talking about Indian democracy and Jan, Gan and Man, it becomes very important. Voter may not be aware. For him or for her, it is important that whatever is here and now should be delivered in next quarter, in next 1 year. Those subjects, as far as the political parties are concerned, we may have ideological differences, but all of them are serving the same motherland. So when it comes to national issues, everybody is one. And that clarity is very much there in most of the good political people. Like anywhere in the world, we will have not so good people also. That's okay. That's part of the democratic setup. As you rightly said, issues like defense, issues like which are core to the central functioning, people certainly look up to the union government to deliver on those issues. And I must say that in the recent past, a government has done a lot to ensure the well-being and ensure that a lot of things are done, despite that we have incidents where we believe that this should not have happened, not only in India, anywhere in the world. It's against humanity. Those challenges we are aware of, and they are more grave than the caste system, than the class system, than our own lacunas of the democracy, terrorism, these kind of things are, and voters are very, very aware of this. And I'm not sure, because this is a live experiment which we'll experience in 2019, but time will tell how the things will change.
So let us know your name and organization, and please make it a brief question, and we'll start up at the front here.
My name is Matthew. Yeah. I work at the Indian Consulate. I appreciate the Consulate General and DCG and all this university and ICCR for arranging this type of informative discussion on these democratic issues. Now, we are in the oldest democratic country, and the largest democratic country is coming for this discussion with the two types of these democracies. In the oldest democratic country, we have only two parties, political parties, Republican or Democratic. But in the largest democratic country in India, we have hundreds of political parties. So how this democracy, is it a challenge for the democracy to govern when hundreds of political parties are involved in this type of democracy? Is it a challenge for the democracy to manage the interests of different political parties in one umbrella or with the govern this single government?
Hi, my name is Einar Magnusson. I'm actually an undergrad student here. Mr. Rossow, you talked at the beginning about how, you know, with, for example, the 2004 election showed a backlash to I guess, urbanization in general in India. And I think, to a larger extent, it kind of also showed a backlash to, you know, the neoliberal and kind of Western form of globalization that had kind of manifested itself in India throughout, you know, following the fall of the Soviet Union. And I think that around that time, you also saw a lot of literature on kind of rebranding India. So my question to Mr. Singh is, how has the, I guess, needs of how has the this kind of backlash to the neoliberal globalization manifested itself in India's kind of democratic structures? And my question to Mr. Chakravorty is, how has, like on an international level, how has India managed to kind of rebrand itself and take advantage of globalization on India's terms?
So, thank you. Multi-parties, boon or bust, and globalization, good or bad?
Regarding the multiple party question, I will not like to comment on the system in the United States, because that is for people in the United States to comment. But as far as my country is concerned, I believe that having or allowing the blossoming of multiple parties has a role in our society, because they are very good outlet points or vents when people feel that they are not being part of the political process or the political process is not answering their needs, they form a political party. Some survive, some perish. But I think it's a natural process. It allows thousand flowers to bloom. Some may become trees, others may not. But I think it's part of the festival of Indian democracy. I don't think we can curb it. It has to be a natural progression. And there may be centralization, I don't know. But I think it allows regional forces to play a role. It allows sub-regional forces to play a role. And I think that is important for the unity of the country. If we try to curb those forces, I think we can pay a big price. And I think the regional and sub-regional forces, they are a response to a particular situation that they face, but they are not against the country. They are also equally patriotic and nationalistic. And I think it has helped India to remain united. That's my personal view about regional parties and sub-regional political formations. As far as globalization is concerned, I think we support the globalization processes. The globalization process itself has deficiencies, and we have seen a backlash against globalization. But I think on the whole, it has allowed countries like India to do well, to eliminate poverty, to become more economically stable and strong. And I think like any process, it has there are weaknesses, and I think the global community has the ability to tackle the challenges of globalization. But I think the solution to globalization is not protectionism. It is not building barriers. It is having more discussion, more interaction, more intercourse between countries. And I think that is the way forward, because we may try to create barriers, but the future is digital, and the future is electronic, the future is virtual, the future is artificial. So I don't know how you can stop that. I think globalization will, the march of technology will continue. And only those countries who are open, who are receptive, will benefit. And I think it's the future of the world is that way. We may be able to moderate it, but I don't think we can stop it. So I think India has benefited from globalization. We are great supporters of globalization, but it has its downfalls. And I think we do course correction from now and then. And we but on the whole, I think we support globalization.
Thank you. So first, coming to your point, the problem when we say in psychology, the problem has some deeper layers also. So the problems, when we say problems in the current context, there is some deeper context to it. India is not a country of one language. India is not a country of one culture. Unity in diversity is our only identity. Why it happened? Because we have, as rightly sir said, we have given people the freedom to express themselves, which has expressed itself in different languages, different cultures, different traditions. So I have nothing more to add, just to say that whenever we say problem, it has some, go down 2-3 more levels, and you will see that there is a beautiful opportunity available to us, particularly in a democratic framework. Rest all, he has already responded. I just echo what he just said. Coming back to you, sir, there is nothing as black backlash in a democracy. Whatever mandate is given by the people of the country, does not matter which part of the hall we are sitting, we have to respect that mandate. We have to reflect that what we have done, what we could do better, and that's how any democracy works. Indian people are 10 steps ahead of any political party in the country. Their ambitions are not local. Their ambitions, with advent of technology, their ambitions are global.
They will contribute whether they are in US or anywhere in the world or in India. They will contribute based on their upbringing of a multiple society where they'll see all kind of people around. They will contribute. So there is nothing as backlash. It is mandate of the people, and we will accept it wherever we are sitting, this side or that side. Thank you.
Well, great. Well, a few points that I jotted down here to take away. Governance is both cause and effect of what we see with electoral trends. Democracy is certainly part of India's DNA, unseen spine, a cool term that I'll probably steal and borrow and use repeatedly after this. I mean, even the communists in India coming to power, going out of power, and more Maoists in India than you've even got in China. So everybody's looking for that kind of outlet, which I think touches a bit on the response in terms of how India survives and thrives with multiple parties. People want responsiveness, shifting from political, where you'd go for responsiveness, but trying to get so that the bureaucracy could be more responsive when people have issues and concerns. And the fact that social media, you know, may end up and be a real boon for that. A lot more people being able to connect could be a real game changer there. I think with the booming schemes right now too, where everybody is getting a lot more access to the things that were before had always been kind of held back from those that weren't privileged, means that you've got a lot more people that are kind of enjoying access to things. I think, you know, Sandeep offered a terrific overview too in terms of the role of a mission like this, you know, trying to corral those external actors that can help India in building good governments and building the kind of things that voters want to see, and the role of being in a distant land and trying to engage in events and people like this. So I hope everybody in the audience will join me in thanking the panelists here. This was a terrific discussion.
Before we close, I'd like to invite one of my colleagues, Dr. Jim Michelli, the Executive Dean of the School of Arts and Sciences, to come say a few words. Among many departments, SAS, the School of Arts and Sciences, is home to the South Asian Studies Program, as well as to the Department of African, Middle Eastern, and South Asian Languages and Cultures, or what we call AMISOL. So, Jim?
I'm really delighted to see everybody here today and to contemplate how this little conference that we've had today really replicates the relationship that we have between Rutgers University on the whole and India. Because as I look out at people who are here, I see students. They're one of the constituencies, one of the groups that we're really proud to have affiliated with us at Rutgers University, both the students who come from India and students who are born to Indian families here in America and come to Rutgers University. We provide a very welcoming environment for you, and we're really happy to see you at an event like this. I also see some faculty here. This is another important connection that we have at Rutgers University, is the ability to bring faculty from Indian backgrounds and heritage to the university. I see a lot of members of the general public, and this is another thing that I think we're really working to build, is the connection that we have to the Indian community in central New Jersey. This is really important for us, and so I'm delighted that we're able to host an event like this and to build that connection. And I also want to mention that we have, as Rick mentioned, the South Asian Studies Program, which is a really central part of our operations in the School of Arts and Sciences. We have over 30 faculty members who have a primary expertise in different facets of Indian culture, Indian society, the Indian economy, Indian business. And this is another thing that we're very proud of and that we want to continue to grow and develop in the years ahead. I think that this great relationship that we have established with the Indian Council on Cultural Relations is something that we're going to really work hard to develop over the coming years. We're very grateful to ICCR for their interest in Rutgers and their partnership with us. And we're also very grateful to the consulate. Consul Chakravorty is here. It was very interesting to hear him speak, and he's really helped a lot to build this relationship with Rutgers. I'm really glad to hear about his job security as well. He's here for the second time in 2 days, and I think the third time in about 2 months. So we're delighted that we have built this really great partnership, and we look forward to building it in the years to come. So thank you all for coming.